Beauty begins the moment you decide by yourself. Believe in yourself and you will be non-stoppable. Happy morning students, I welcome you all to this online class. In unit 2, we have completed the 5th chapter molecular genetics and today we start our 6th chapter evolution.
The term evolution is used to describe heritable changes in one or more characteristics of a population of species from one generation to the other. The present state of mankind on earth is the outcome of three kinds of evolution. One is the chemical, organic and social or cultural evolution. Radiometric dating of meteoroids yields an estimated age of for the solar system and for earth as around 4.5 to 4.6 billion years. So radiometric dating of meteoroids estimated the age of the earth that it was around 4.5 to 4.6 billion years. The newborn earth remained inhospitable for at least few hundred million years. At first the earth was too hot. This is because the collision of planetesimals that collided to form the earth released much heat to melt the entire planet. So at the starting the earth was too hot because of the collision of this planets from the earth and it melted the entire earth. Eventually the outer surface of the earth cooled and solidified to form a crust. Water vapor released from the planet's interior cooled and condensed to form oceans. So how oceans are formed? The water vapor released from the planets. So planet kulla iruka water vapor condense aagi ocean ah form aagum. Hence origin of life can be reconstructed using indirect evidences. Consequently biologists have turned to gather disparate bits of information and filling them together like pieces of jigsaw puzzles. So many informations are collected by the biologist about the origin of life. So many theories have been proposed to explain the origin of life. Few of them are, first one is the theory of special creation. Theory of special creation states that the life was created by a supernatural power. Supernatural power here is referred to as God. So according to Hinduism, Lord Brahma created the earth. According to Christian, Islam and most religions, they believe that God created the universe, plants and the animals. So the superior power, God has created the earth. So this was the theory of special creation. The next theory is the theory of spontaneous generation. It is also called as abiogenesis. Abiogenesis. A means absence of, bio means living, so non-living. So living organisms are originated from the non-living materials and occurred through stepwise chemical and molecular evolution over millions of years. So this theory was proposed or this theory was coined by Thomas Huxley. So according to abiogenesis, the living organisms are originated from the non-living materials. The next theory is the Big Bang theory, which explains the origin of universe as a singular huge explosion in physical terms, Big Bang. So it is a huge explosion in physical terms. So the primitive earth had no proper atmosphere, but it has only helium and hydrogen. It consisted of ammonia, methane, hydrogen and water vapor. The climate of the earth was extremely high. Ultraviolet rays from the sun splits up the water molecules into hydrogen and oxygen. So the ultraviolet rays that is emitted splits the water molecule into hydrogen and oxygen. Gradually the temperature cooled and the water vapor condensed to form rain. So rain filled all the depressions to form water bodies. Ammonia and methane in the atmosphere combined with oxygen to form carbon dioxide and other gases. How carbon dioxide and other gases are formed? Ammonia and methane combines with oxygen to form carbon dioxide and other gases. And the next theory is the theory of biogenesis. So according to the theory of biogenesis, that means life exists from the other living things. So life arose from the pre-existing life. The term biogenesis also refers to the biochemical process of production of living organisms. So living organisms are formed from other living organisms. So this is called the theory of biogenesis, and this term was coined by Henri Bastian. Next comes the theory of chemical evolution. According to this theory, the primitive organisms in the primordial environment of the earth evolved spontaneously from the inorganic substances. So organisms are formed from the inorganic substances and physical forces such as lightning, ultraviolet radiation and volcanic activities. There come two scientists, Oparin and Haldane. They suggested that the organic compounds could have undergone a series of reactions leading to a complex molecules. He proposed the molecules formed colloidal aggregates or coservates. So Oparin said that the molecules are combined to form aggregate structure, colloidal aggregates in an aqueous environment. The coservates were able to absorb and assimilate organic compounds from the environment. Haldane in 1929 proposed the primordial sea served as a vast chemical laboratory powered by the solar energy. So this primordial sea was given by the Haldane. The atmosphere was oxygen free, and the combination of carbon dioxide, methane and ultraviolet radiation gives rise to the inorganic compounds. The sea became a hot dilute soup containing large population of organic monomers and polymers. Monomers means a single unit and the polymers means many units of these substances are combined. They invested that groups of monomers and polymers occurred, lipid membranes, and further developed into the first living cells. So this forms the first living cell. The Haldane coined the term prebiotic soup. Prebiotic soup is the term coined by Haldane, and this became the powerful symbol for the Oparin-Haldane view on the origin of life. Oparin and Haldane independently suggested that if the primitive atmosphere were reducing and if there was appropriate supply of energy such as lightning or ultraviolet light, then a wide range of organic compounds can be synthesized. So they suggested that with the help of lightning and ultraviolet radiations, organic compounds can be synthesized. Have you ever think about the age of our earth? How old is the earth? Yes, it is 4.6 billion years. That is 4 into 6 and 8 zeros. The zoological time scale, the duration of the earth history, has been divided into eras that include the Paleozoic, Mesozoic and Cenozoic eras. The time scale gives the whole history as eons, era, period and epochs. They have some interesting names. The Precambrian period starts when life first appears, as they are in very simple form of bacteria. It can be viewed only under microscope. In Precambrian period, the single-cell organisms and bacteria were the only animal found on the earth. The first multicellular organism appeared at the end of this Precambrian period. The Precambrian period ended about 514 million years ago. The multicellular organism may be the plants and animals. The next comes the Paleozoic era, which is characterized by abundance of fossils of marine invertebrates, and it's divided into seven periods starting from Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, Carboniferous and Permian. And towards the latter half, the other vertebrates, marine and terrestrial, except the birds and mammals, were appeared. And this Paleozoic era is called as the age of invertebrates to the earliest reptiles or mammal-like reptiles. Extinction. Mass extinction at the end of the Permian period takes place. We don't know exactly what had happened, but 251 million years ago, 83% of life on Earth was wound up. Next era is the Mesozoic era, the dominance of reptiles called as the Golden Age of Reptiles. Mesozoic era is called the Golden Age of Reptiles and is divided into three periods, namely Triassic, Jurassic and Cretaceous. This Triassic origin of egg-laying mammals and Jurassic is the dinosaurs and the Cretaceous of toothed birds and dinosaurs, emergence of modern birds appeared. Here also extinction at the end of the Cretaceous period then comes. Extinction of dinosaurs and many other animals likewise happened in the Permian period also. This extinction wind up all the species, but luckily some mammals survived at the end of this Cretaceous extinction. The next era is the Cenozoic era, the age of mammals, and is divided into two periods, namely Tertiary and Quaternary. The Tertiary period is characterized by abundant mammalian fauna and is divided into five epochs. And this Tertiary period includes 66 to 2.6 million years ago. Then comes the Quaternary period where human arises. It begins from 2.6 million years ago. This Quaternary period witnessed the decline of mammals and beginning of human social life. And this Quaternary and the Tertiary period belongs to the Cenozoic era, which is the age of mammals. The age of fossils can be determined using two methods, namely relative dating and absolute dating. What is relative dating? Relative dating is used to determine a fossil by comparing it to similar rocks and fossils of known age. Relative dating means comparing the fossil with a similar rocks or fossil. And the absolute dating is used to determine the precise age of a fossil by using radiometric dating to measure the decay of isotopes. So for absolute dating, we can use the radiometric isotopes, and whereas in relative dating, we can compare it with the similar rocks or fossils. So these are the two ways or methods to determine the age of fossil. It's an important 2-mark question. Next comes the biological evolution, that is the formation of protobionts. Abiotically produced molecules can spontaneously self-assemble into droplets. Abiotically produced, that means the things which do not have life. Abiotically produced molecules can spontaneously self-assemble. They self-assemble into a droplet that encloses a variety or that encloses a watery solution and maintain a chemical environment different from their surrounding. So this abiotically produced molecule forms a watery solution. Okay, scientists call these spheres as protobionts. So what are protobionts? Protobionts are the abiotically produced molecules which self-assemble into droplets that enclose a watery solution and maintain a chemical environment different from the surrounding. So liposomes or lipids in a solution that can self-assemble into lipid bilayer. Some of the proteins inside the liposomes acquire the properties of enzymes, resulting in fast multiplication of molecules. If you see the cell membrane, it consists of lipids and proteins. So the causerates with the nucleoprotein and nutrient had a limiting surface membrane that had the character of a virus or a free living genes. What is meant by conservates? Conservate is nothing but aggregation of a substance with nucleoprotein and nutrients. It has a surface membrane which has the characteristics of a virus. Subsequently, number of genes united to form the protovirus, somewhat it is similar to that of the present day viruses. Two major cell types have appeared during this time. So one is the Monera, another one is the Protista. One form of the earliest cell contains clumps means group of nucleoprotein embedded in a cell substance. Such cells were similar to that of Monera. The cell substance, that is the cytoplasm and the nucleoprotein, are embedded or added or closed. Okay, they are considered as a Monera. They are considered as the ancestral to the modern bacteria and the blue-green algae. The other form of the earliest cells contain a nucleoprotein clumps that condensed into the central mass surrounded by a thin membrane. Here, in the second part, the nucleoprotein is covered by a nuclear membrane. That means nucleus is separated from the cytoplasm. This membrane separated the nucleoprotein from the cell substances. Such cells were referred to as protista. So you can heard about prokaryotes and eukaryotes. In prokaryotes, the cells do not have a well-defined nucleus, that is called as Monera. Whereas in eukaryotes, the nucleus is well-defined. So it is called as protista. So two major cell types are appeared. When the natural sources of the food in the ocean is declined in course of time, the ancestor of this Monera and Protista had to evolve different methods for food procurement. That means in order to take the food, this Monera and Protista have to go for some other sources. They may be parasitism. They may live as a parasite or a saprophyte, a predator. Or it can produce by itself. That means by the process of chemosynthesis and photosynthesis. When the number of photosynthetic organisms increased, there was an increase in the free oxygen in the sea and atmosphere. The atmospheric oxygen combined with methane and ammonia to form carbon dioxide and free nitrogen. You can see in this equation. The presence of free oxygen brought about the evolution of aerobic respiration. If the oxygen level increases, aerobic respiration is evolved, which could yield a large amount of energy by oxidation of foodstuffs. So what is the use of oxygen? It is helpful for oxidation of a foodstuff to yield energy. Thus, prokaryotes and eukaryotes have evolved. Urey and Miller, in 1953, paved way for understanding the possible synthesis of organic compounds that led to the appearance of living organisms. The temperature of the primitive earth was so high and the atoms combined with one another. Oxygen did not occur in free state. As time passed by, the steam condensed to form water and it gives the rain. Oparin and Haldane gives independent suggested that if the primitive atmosphere reducing and if there was an appropriate source of energy such as lightning, there is a wide range of organic compound can be synthesized. So this is the Urey-Miller experiment with a cooling jacket, water in, water out, and it is the water which produces steam. And this is the vacuum pump and this is a flask which helps to analyze the sample. So, a small flask was kept boiling and the steam emanating from it was made to mix with the mixture of gases. The mixture of gases contained ammonia, methane and hydrogen in a large chamber that was connected to the boiling water. The steam condensed to form water which ran down the YouTube. The experiment was conducted continuously for a week and the liquid was analyzed. So see in this, the liquid, condensed liquid comes and collected in this jar, which consists of different types of amino acids such as glycine, alanine, beta alanine and aspartic acid. Thus, Miller experiment had an insight as to the possibility of abiogenetic synthesis of large amount of variety of organic compounds in nature from a mixture of sample gases in which the only source of carbon was methane. Later, in similar experiments, formation of all types of amino acids and nitrogen bases were noticed. Next, we see certain evidences for biological evolution. The first evidence is the paleontological evidence. What is meant by paleontology? Paleontology is the study of prehistoric life through fossils. Paleo means fossils, and logy means and study. The study of prehistoric life through fossils is called as paleontology. Fossils are described as true witnesses of evolution or documents of various geological strata of evolution. So fossils are the records. So these are the records of the animals which is lived in the past. Fossilization is the process by which plant and animal remains are preserved in sedimentary rocks. Fossilization is the method or the process in which the plants and animals are preserved in sedimentary rocks. There are three main categories of this fossilization. First one is the actual remains. The original hard parts such as bones, teeth or shells are preserved as such in the earth's atmosphere. You can see in these pictures. So this is the most common method of fossilization. When marine animals die, their hard parts such as bone, shells, etc. are covered with sediments and are protected from further deterioration. That means further damage. They get preserved as such. They are preserved in vast ocean. The salinity in them prevents decay. Salinity means the presence of salt in the sea prevents the decay of such organisms. So the sediments become hardened to form a definite layers of strata. So for example, woolly mammoth that lived 22,000 years ago were preserved in the frozen coast of Siberia as such. Several human beings and animals living in the ancient city of Pompeii were preserved intact by volcanic ash which gushed out from the Mount Vesuvius. So from the volcanic ashes, from the Mount Vesuvius, the volcanoes. So some people died in the city of Pompeii. So you can see in this picture, some are sitting and some are lying down. So they are preserved as such with the volcanic ashes. Next one is the petrification. So when animals die, the original portion of the body may be replaced molecule for a molecule by minerals and the original substance being lost through disintegration. So this method of fossilization is called as petrification. Important 2-mark question. When animals die, the original portion of the body may be replaced. The original portion of the body is replaced by molecule for molecule by minerals. And the original substance being lost through disintegration. The skins, they disintegrate, but the molecules are replaced by the minerals. So the principal minerals involved in this type of fossilization are iron, pyrites, silica, calcium carbonate and bicarbonates of calcium and magnesium. And the third method is the natural method that cast. Even after disintegration, the body of an animal might leave an indelible impression on the soft mud, which later becomes hardened into stones. Such impressions are called as molds. So, பிள்ளையார் சதுரத்திலாம் வருது. அப்போ அந்த பிள்ளையார் சதுரத்துக்காக ஒரு அச்சு வச்சிருப்பாங்க இல்லையா? ஸோ அதுதான் வந்து மோல்ட். ஸோ த பாடி ஆஃப் அன் அனிமல் மைட் லீவ் அன் இம்ப்ரெஷன் ஆன் த சாஃப்ட் மட் தட் இஸ் கால்ட் அஸ் மோல்ஸ். ஸோ த கேவிட்டி ஆஃப் த மோல்ஸ் மே பி ஃபில்ட் அப் வித் ஹார்ட் மினரல்ஸ் அண்ட் கெட் ஃபாஸ்டிலைஸ்ட். ஸோ தட் கேப் இஸ் ஃபில்ட் அப் வித் சர்டேன். ஸோ அதே பிள்ளையார் சிலை செய்யும்போது இப்போ கிளே அதெல்லாம் வச்சு அப்படி ப்ரெஸ் பண்ணி ஒரு சிலையை உருவாக்குறாங்க இல்லையா? ஸோ தட் இஸ் கால்ட் அஸ் காஸ்ட். வாட் இஸ் மோல்ட் அண்ட் வாட் இஸ் காஸ்ட்? மோல்டுன்னா அந்த அச்சு, காஸ்ட்டுன்னா உள்ளே இருக்கக்கூடிய அந்த இது. minerals. Okay, so hard and fickle matter termed as coprolites. So what is meant by coprolites? Coprolite is nothing but the hard and fecal matter. Fecal means excretory product of some animals. It also occur as tiny pellets. So you can see in a goat, you can see the goat's fecal matter. So analysis of the coprolites enable us to understand the nature of the diet. We will see the evidences from comparative anatomy. Similarities in structure between groups of organisms are accepted as indicators of relationship. For example, comparative study of volumes of different vertebrates exhibit a fundamental plan of similarity in structures. So, similarity in their structure indicates a great comparative anatomy. So, ஒரு அனிமல்ஸை கம்பேர் பண்ணணும்னா ஒற்றுமைகள் இருக்கணும் இல்லையா? ஸோ ஃபோலியம்ஸ் வச்சு அந்த கம்பேரிட்டிவ் ஸ்டடி படிக்கிறாங்க. ஸோ தீஸ் ரிலேஷன்ஷிப்ஸ் கேன் பி ஸ்டடி அண்டர் ஹோமோலோகஸ் ஆர்கன்ஸ், அனலோகஸ் ஆர்கன்ஸ், வெஸ்டீஜியல் ஆர்கன்ஸ், கனெக்டிங் லிங்க்ஸ் அண்ட் அட்டாவிஸ்டிக் ஆர்கன்ஸ். வி வில் சி ஒன் பை ஒன். ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஒன் இஸ் த ஹோமோலோகஸ் ஆர்கன். ஹோமோலோகஸ் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர்ஸ், ஃபோர் லிம்ஸ் ஆஃப் வெர்டிபிரேட்ஸ் எக்ஸிபிட் அனாட்டாமிக்கலி சிமிலாரிட்டி with each other and is made up of similar bones such as. So most of the vertebrate forelimbs vandu paathona similar structures irukum. Enna enna bones irukku adula? Humerus, radius, ulna, carpals, metacarpals and phalanges. Structures which are similar in origin but perform different functions are called homologous structures. That brings about divergent evolution. Structures similar irukum ana functions may be different. So that is called as homologous structures. It is also called divergent evolution. So similarly in plants, the thorns of bougainvillea, thorns na mullu irukum illaya bougainvillea plant, and the tendrils of cucurbita represents the homology. The thorns is used as a defense mechanism for grazing animals and the tendrils is used as a support for climbing. Okay, next one, analogous structures. Organisms having different structure pattern but similar function are termed as analogous structures. Structure different, function ore maadhiri irukum. For example, the wings of birds and insects are different structurally. So birds nodiya wings so insect oda wings so structural are different, but they perform the same function of flight that brings about convergent evolution. So question ipdiyum kekkalam, divergent evolution convergent evolution na enna? Divergent na structure similar, functions different. Convergent evolution na structure different, function is similar. So other examples of analogous organs include the eyes of the octopus and mammals and the flippers of penguins. Penguin oda flippers na our hand irukla adu, and dolphins. And in plants, a root modification in sweet potato and stem modification in potato are considered as analogous organs. So plants la kuda sweet potato root modification, potato stem modification, they are all analogous structures, but they both for storage of food. Next one is the vestigial organ. Structures that are of no use to the possessors. Use illada structure. Structures that are of no use to the possessor and are not necessary for their existence is called vestigial organ. அது இருந்தா தான் உயிர் வாழணும்ன்ற அவசியம் இல்லை, இல்லாமலும் உயிர் வாழ முடியும் இல்லையா? So such structures are called as vestigial organs. Vestigial organs were well developed and functional in the ancestors but disappeared in course of evolution. நம்மளுடைய ancestors-க்கு அது வெல் டெவலப்டா இருக்கலாம், ஆனா course of evolution-ல அது என்ன ஆகுது, disappear ஆயிடுச்சு. Human appendix is the remnant of a cecum which is functional in the digestive tract of a herbivorous animal like rabbit. Appendix நமக்கு தெரியும், நம்மளுடைய அந்த cecum, cecum-ன்றது it's a part of a large intestine.
ஸோ அதுக்கெல்லாம் ஒரு சின்ன பிளண்ட் டியூப் மாதிரி இருக்கும், தட் இஸ் கால்ட் அப்பண்டிக்ஸ். அந்த அப்பண்டிக்ஸு இதுக்கு முன்னாடி ரேபிட்டில், ரேபிட்ன்றது ஒரு ஹெர்பிவோரஸ் அனிமல், பிளான்ட் ஈட்டிங் அனிமல்ஸ். பிளான்ட் பிளான்ட்ஸ் இஸ் மேட் அப் ஆஃப் செல்வால், செல்வாலில் செல்லுலோஸ் இருக்கும். ஸோ செல்லுலோஸ் டைஜஸ்ட் பண்ணுறதுக்காக தான் சீக்கம்ல அந்த அப்பண்டிக்ஸ் இருந்துச்சு. ஆனால் ஹியூமனுக்கு அப்பண்டிக்ஸ்ன்றது ஒரு ரெமனன்ட் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர். ஸோ செல்லுலோஸ் டைஜஷன் டேக்ஸ் பிளேஸ் இன் த சீக்கம் ஆஃப் அ ரேபிட் டியூ டு சேஞ்ச் இன் த டயட் கண்டெய்னிங் லெஸ் செல்லுலோஸ். இப்போ நம்ம சாப்பிட்ற சாப்பாடில் செல்லுலோஸ் கண்டென்ட் கம்மியாக இருக்கு. Cecum in the human became functionless and is reduced to a vermiform appendix which is a vestigial organ. Other examples of vestigial organs in human beings include cocci, wisdom teeth, ear muscles, body hair, mammae in males. Female la da mammary gland irukum, but in males it is a rudimentary, okay, nictitating membrane of the eye. So these are some of the examples of vestigial organs in human beings. Next one, connecting link. What is connecting link? The organisms which possess the character of two different groups. ரெண்டு குரூப்புக்கு நடுவுல இருக்கும் இல்லையா, ஸோ அதுதான் கனெக்டிங் லிங்க். எக்ஸாம்பிள் ஃபார் திஸ் இஸ் பெரிபாட்டஸ். Peripatus is a connecting link between annelids and arthropods. It shows both the character of phylum Annelida and Arthropoda. Second one is the Archaeopteryx. Archaeopteryx is a connecting link between the reptiles and the birds. That means aves. Next is atavistic organs. What are atavistic organs? It's a very important 2-mark question. Sudden appearance of vestigial organs in highly evolved organisms is called atavistic organ. Sudden appearance, adhan keyword. Sudden appearance of vestigial organs in highly evolved organisms is called atavistic organs. Example for this is presence of tail in a human baby is an atavistic organ. You can see in this picture. So, presence of tail in a human baby is an atavistic organ. Next is the embryological evolution. Embryological evidences. What is embryology? Embryology deals with the study of development of individual from the egg to the adult stage. Eggல இருந்து adult stage வரைக்கும் என்னென்ன development ஆகுது? அதுதான் embryology. So the development of heart in all vertebrates follows the same pattern of development as a pair of tubular structure. முதல்ல development of heart vertebratesல பார்த்தோம்னா ஒரு tubular structures போல தான் ஒரு இருந்துச்சு. That later develops into two-chambered. அப்புறம் two-chambered-ஆ மாறிச்சு. எதுல? Fishes-ல. Then three-chambered in amphibians and in most reptiles. Most reptiles-லயும் 3-chambered da, but in crocodile it is 4-chambered heart. Birds, mammals, ellathilume 4-chambered, indicating a common ancestry from all the vertebrates. So appa heart aduve or example, embryological evidences. So from lower classes to the higher classes it develops. Hence scientists in the 19th century concluded that higher animals during their embryonic development pass through stages of lower animals. Ernest von Haeckel propounded the law called biogenetic law or theory of recapitulation. One mark it will be asked, who propounded the biogenetic law? Ernest von Haeckel. So which states that life history of an individual, ஒரு இண்டிவிஜுவலோட லைஃப் ஹிஸ்ட்ரி, தட் மீன்ஸ் ஆன்டோஜெனி, பிரீஃப்லி ரிப்பீட்ஸ், அது ரிப்பீட் ஆகுது, ஆர் ஹி கேப்சுலேட்ஸ் த எவல்யூஷனரி ஹிஸ்ட்ரி ஆஃப் த ரேஸ். ஸோ அது அப்படியே அதனுடைய எவல்யூஷனை அது அப்படியே கொண்டு வரும். தட் இஸ் ஃபைலோஜெனி. இவ்வளோ பெருசாக எழுதுனா 2 மார்க் கேட்கலாம். ஸ்டேட் பயோஜெனடிக் லா. Biogenetic law states that the life history of an individual briefly repeats or recapitulates the evolutionary history of the race. In other words, you can write ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. இதான் சிம்பிளான வார்த்தை. Ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. The embryonic stages of a higher animals resembles the adult stage of its ancestors. So appearance of pharyngeal gill slits, yolk sac and presence of tail in human embryos are some of the examples of this. The comparative study of the embryo of different animals shows structural similarities among themselves. The embryo of fish, salamander, tortoise, chick and human start life as a single cell. All animals, எப்படி ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணுது லைஃப், சிங்கிள் செல்லாக தான் ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணுது. தட் இஸ் த ஜைகோட் தட் ஃபார்ம்ட் ஆஃப்டர் ஃபர்டிலைசேஷன் அண்ட் அண்டர் கோஸ் கிளீவேஜ் உடையது டு ப்ரொடியூஸ் பிளாஸ்டுலா, சேஞ்ச் இன் டு கேஸ்டுலா அண்ட் ஆர் ட்ரிப்ளோ பிளாஸ்டிக். திஸ் இண்டிகேட்ஸ் தட் ஆல் த அபவ் செட் அனிமல்ஸ் ஹவ் இவால்வ் ஃப்ரம் காமன் ஆன்செஸ்டர்ஸ். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் த எவிடன்சஸ் ஃப்ரம் எம்பிரியாலஜி. நெக்ஸ்ட் இஸ் த மாலிகுலார் எவிடன்ஸ். மாலிகுலார் அப்படின்னு டிஎன்ஏ ஆர்என்ஏன்றது உன் மைண்டில் வந்துடும். ஸோ மாலிகுலார் எவல்யூஷன் இஸ் த ப்ராசஸ் ஆஃப் சேஞ்ச் இன் த சீக்வன்ஸ் காம்போசிஷன் ஆஃப் மாலிகுல்ஸ் சச் ஆஸ் டிஎன்ஏ ஆர்என்ஏ அண்ட் ப்ரோட்டீன்ஸ் அக்ராஸ் ஜெனரேஷன். ஸோ மாலிகுலார் எவல்யூஷன்றது அந்த டிஎன்ஏ ஆர்என்ஏ சீக்வன்ஸில் ஏதாவது சேஞ்ச் இருக்கணும். It uses the principles of evolutionary biology and population genetics to explain the patterns in the changes of molecules. So one of the most important useful advancement in the development of molecular biology is proteins and other molecules that control life processes or conserved among species. Species la ஒரு organism nal it is made up of proteins. இல்லையா அண்ட் அதர் மாலிகுல் சச் அஸ் ஜிஎன்ஏ ஆர்என்ஏ. ஸோ இதனுடைய அட்வான்ஸ்மெண்ட் தான் மாலிகுலார் எவிடன்சஸ்க்கு முக்கிய காரணமாக இருக்குது. அ ஸ்லைட் சேஞ்ச் தட் அக்கர் ஓவர் டைம் இன் தீஸ் கன்சர்வ்ட் மாலிகுல்ஸ், சின்னதாக சேஞ்ச் இருந்தாலும் இந்த டிஎன்ஏ ஆர்என்ஏ ப்ரோட்டீன்ஸில் இருந்தாலும் ஓகேவா, ஸோ தட் ஆர் ஆஃபன் கால்டு மாலிகுலார் கிளாக்ஸ். மாலிகுல்ஸ் தட் ஹாவ் பீன் யூஸ் டு ஸ்டடி எவல்யூஷன் ஆர் சைட்டோக்ரோம் சி which is used as a respiratory pathway and rRNA. rRNA is ribosomal RNA which is involved in protein synthesis.